a lifelong Republican. Why are you supporting Joe Biden?
Well, Jake, I'm doing this because, one, I did not support President Trump in 2016. I did not vote for him. I'm not going to do it in 2020. But at the end of the day, you know, this really isn't about right or left. It's not about ideology, not right or left. For me, it's about right or wrong. Stability versus instability, security versus insecurity, you know, normal versus abnormal. That's why I'm doing this, because I feel that we need to return some sense of normalcy to the function of government. We simply don't have that now. And that's why I'm going to be voting for Joe Biden for president.
So I'm sure you are going to hear from a lot of Republican colleagues, current and former Republican congressmen, who say Joe Biden is a Democrat, Charlie, you're a Republican, and the Democratic Party is far more to the left than it used to be. And look, I get you don't like the president's style, but what about the substance of his actions, the tax cuts, the conservative judges, the rolling back regulations? What are you going to say to them?
Well, I'm going to say to them, if we want to talk policy, let's talk about national security. I never in my wildest dreams thought a Republican president would be cozying up to somebody like Vladimir Putin and advancing his foreign policy objectives in Europe and in the Middle East. On trade, I never thought we'd have a Republican president who would be, you know, throwing around tariffs, taxes on American citizens and being so opposed to opening markets for American producers. Those are just two very specific examples. Healthcare. When the president told me I was going to destroy the Republican Party, he was the one, you know, who really never advanced a real plan to provide health care to Americans. And I think that was a major failing. So those are three policy areas where I had very significant disagreements. But there are principles, Jake, you know, greater than a tax cut or a lighter regulatory touch, which I support. There are greater principles involved, like the rule of law. You know, we have to defend democratic values, and I say democratic with a small d, you know, a free press, an independent judiciary. I mean, these are things that are very important, and the president has been trying to undermine those things. And I think that, again, we have to talk about broader principles here rather than just an immediate policy victory.
Do you think that you and other Republicans, John Kasich, Christy Todd Whitman, Meg Whitman, Colin Powell, et cetera, do you think you're endorsing Trump will have any impact, do you think? I mean, it happened in 2016, too. Some Republicans endorsed Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it'll have an impact, but I do think that the people you just mentioned, including myself, might have some sway with people who find themselves somewhere between center-right and center-left on the political spectrum. I think many of those people will maybe take note of what we're saying, but I do think that there are many people in this country who are Republicans and who are unhappy with the direction of the party, that the party has become too socially intolerant. It has not been constructive on the international stage. And I think we have to get back to, you know, free markets and, you know, with reasonable regulation. And we need to get to a better place as a party. We are simply not there. And there are many Republicans who agree with me on this. They might not be stating it the way I am, but I can assure you, I hear from them regularly about the sad state of affairs right now in the party. And there's going to be a reckoning, in my view, after the election, should President Trump be defeated. And if the Senate were to flip, I suspect there's going to be a real conversation about what this party should look like. Should Trumpism survive Trump? And we're going to have a great debate.
So Trump won the great Commonwealth of Pennsylvania in 2016. That's one of the reasons he is president, flipping that state, which is traditionally went for Democrats in presidential races. What are you hearing when you go back to Pennsylvania? Do you think he might keep Pennsylvania red, or might it go to Biden?
Well, yeah, looking at this analytically, right now, I think it's improbable that he would win re-election in Pennsylvania, simply because the suburban erosion for Republicans has been dramatic since the president was elected. 2017, 18, and 19 have been very unkind to Republicans, particularly in suburban communities in your areas of the collar counties of Philadelphia, the suburbs in the Lehigh Valley, Pittsburgh, and even Harrisburg. That situation has eroded considerably. And I would also argue, too, that the president, while he's done very well upstate in the rural areas, I don't believe there are enough rural voters out there to offset the losses that Republicans have experienced in those suburban communities I just identified. So the president ran a perfect straight. Pulled a perfect straight in 2016. He'd have to do it again. He only won by 44,000 votes. But as I said, the suburban situation is much worse. Joe Biden is not Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton lost because her vote collapsed outside of the Philadelphia region. And again, Biden is not Clinton.
In the last week or so, you were talking about the future of the Republican Party, if Trump wins or if he doesn't. In the last week or so, two completely unhinged conspiracy theorists, both of them complete bigots as well, have won Republican congressional nominations. Marjorie Taylor Greene in Georgia in a Republican district, and Laura Loomer in Florida in a district that leans Democratic. President Trump has praised both of them, gone out of his way to say positive things about these really unlikable candidates in terms of the things that they say and do. Is it possible, Congressman, is it possible that the Republican Party is now the party of deranged bigots and there isn't a place in it any longer for a Charlie Dent?
Well, look, part of the reason I'm doing this today is because of what happened last week. I wrote an op-ed. I was on John King's show and we talked about the QAnon conspiracy candidate down in Georgia. I mean, a 9/11 truther, for Pete's sake, and the president called this person a rising star. I mean, all this does is empower, you know, the whack jobs and the nuts to come out. And I think, you know, with strong leadership, you know, we should be able to marginalize folks like that. And it's really a sad state of the affairs when the president, you know, endorses a 9/11 truther. I mean, it's just beyond me. You know, I grew up in a Republican Party in Pennsylvania where we had people like Bill Scranton Sr. and, you know, and Dick Thornburg and John Hines and Arlen Specter and Tom Ridge and the Schweikers. I mean, really good, solid people, responsible people. And, you know, that was the party that I was always proud to be part of. And it's a sad state of affairs. I mean, I know that I can't imagine any of them would have appreciated any of this that's happening right now. And I think we need to have this debate about the future of the party. And we need to get serious adults engaged. Because I know, look, I have a lot of friends who are in Congress on the Republican side. And look, I know they're just as frustrated as I am. And they're not as in a position maybe to say it as I can, but they're frustrated. And they know this is very difficult and that they're all in a bad situation, as is the party. And I can already see people angling, you know, for a post-Trump world. So I'm looking forward to that. And one final thing, too, Jake. You know, I never thought in my wildest dreams a Republican president would be standing up there defending the Confederacy or Confederate symbols. I mean, how crazy is that? I mean, it's just beyond belief to me, beyond description.